To welcome you to today's talk as co-sponsored by the East Asia Center and the Tibet Center. Ari, are there other sponsors? Great, okay. And so Brandon Dotson, associate professor from Georgetown University, and a strange gift and its stranger beneficiaries. So I've known Brandon for a number of years. He's one of the leading experts in the world on the imperial period of Tibetan culture, people, religion, literature, language, and so forth from 600 into the 9th century. And in that capacity, he's published a number of major works, both books and articles and edited volumes. Do we have them here? Not exactly, okay. So the Old Tibetan Annals, an annotated translation of Tibet's first history, and then, I'm not sure I'll pronounce that correctly, Codicology?
Sure.
Why not? Codicology, Paleography and Orthography of Early Tibetan Documents, Methods, and a Case Study, two books. Also a number of major articles and four edited volumes, Kingship, Ritual, Narrative in Tibet and Surrounding the Cultural Area, right here, and three other books as well about early Tibet, contemporary visions in Tibetan studies, and a second book on early Tibet, so four edited volumes altogether. I think what's most impressive about Brandon is on the one hand, he has this very deep vertical expertise in a particular area of Tibetan studies, namely the Tibetan Empire and so forth. And in that, he has achieved excellence, one of the top two or three people in the world in that particular area, I think, in most of our opinions. And that itself is remarkable. I mean, a lot of people have deep vertical expertise, but they don't become one of the top people in the world in that field. But the other thing I think that really impressed upon me when I first started hearing Brandon talk on a variety of subjects is that almost every subject he talks about turns out to be creative, engaging, and unexpected. Now, I typically am infamous for falling asleep at talks, but you'll see that I don't fall asleep today. And many talks that you do, you can pretty much see the beginning, the middle, and end the moment it starts. And one of the things that I have most admired and respected about Brandon is that I have no idea what he's going to do. And he'll say, I'm going to talk about subject X. And I think, huh, wouldn't have expected you to talk about that subject. And then he talks about it in ways that I never would have expected anyone was going to talk about that subject. And so we're in the presence with Brandon, someone who has a really engaging, creative, articulate mind that he brings to whatever subject he looks at. And he finds these really creative, unexpected, interpretive pathways that synthesize various areas in ways that I'm really not sure anybody else quite would have done. And there aren't a whole lot of scholars in any field who do that. And so I think those two sides of Brandon, namely one, this deep vertical expertise that has put him in the kind of paramount position in terms of the Tibetan Empire and this early period of Tibetan culture and politics and literature, but then also this ability to work through a broad variety of materials in creative and unexpected ways. So it's with great pleasure today that I welcome him to give a talk on 1,650 sutras copied for the Tibetan Emperor. So please join me in welcoming Brandon Dotson.
Thank you very much for that moving introduction. I'm not going to live up to that. I mean, it's kind of difficult because I'm talking about this topic today, and you see I catch you off guard with what I talk about. I usually like to talk about interesting stuff. I work on divination. I work on animals. I work on ethics. That's interesting. We're talking about scribes in the scriptorium copying 1,650 sutras. When I say I've done this, and I've been doing this for the last 3, 4, 5 years, going and documenting sutra after sutra after sutra, the most common response is, why? Why would you do that? So I'm sorry to say this is an instance where I'm giving you the boring stuff today. I'm going to try to keep it interesting by couching it as a series of detective stories. I'll be talking about the Aparamitaya Lama Mahayana Sutra. That sutra is basically the Buddhist equivalent of a chain letter. You know what a chain letter is? I don't know if we still have chain letters, but that's where somebody gives you a letter and they say, you need to copy this out 10 times and give it to 10 more people. And if you do that, X, Y, and Z will happen to you. and you'll get these benefits from it. So if you don't do it, there's also some bad things that might happen to you. I had a knock on the door yesterday, and it was loud knocking, and somebody ran away. Bag of candy, and a note that said, "You've been booed." It was a new kind of chain letter, a spooky chain letter. Bag full of candy, and it said, "Go and do this to two more people. Fill two bags of candy and send them to a few more people." So I'll see what I can do in terms of making this into a spooky chain letter in honor of Halloween. But as I say, most people think it's boring. Right, so there's sets of threes here. I'll be talking about the objects, namely the roll, or the horizontal scroll, and the booklet. I'll be talking about the recipients of these objects, the emperor and the explorer. The emperor is Kritsukesen. Most of you may know him as Rinpoche. May 15, 841, emperor of the Tibetan Empire, and the explorer, Mark Orell Stein, British-Hungarian explorer, made famous from books like Peter Hopkirk's Foreign Devils on the Silk Road. And finally, the third corner of this semiotic triangle, the labor. So on the one hand, you have 9th century scribes and editors in Dunhuang, in the scriptoria of Dunhuang, mostly ethnic Chinese. And then on the other hand, you have 20th and 21st century catalogers and conservators in London. So I'm going to be weaving the experiences of these people together, the scribes on the one hand, the conservators, and the catalogers on the other, the emperor and the explorer, and also focusing most of all on these objects. So I'll do that by way of talking about three different mysteries. First, you have the case of the disappearing scrolls. Second, the case of the rubbed out scribes. And then third, and last, and this is probably least, although this is where the title comes from, this case of the strange gift. So for those of you who don't know, let's zero in on where we are. We're talking about Dunhuang. Dunhuang is generally a very important Manchukuo on the Silk Road. You see, it's almost where the northern and southern Silk Road meet. It's just a little ways along the southern Silk Road. So it became extremely important as a multi-ethnic center. And you have the Mogao cave complex, where people are carving caves out of the walls there and dedicating them to their ancestors and to others. The town is about 6 miles from Dunhuang. It's Shazhou. And Shazhou and Dunhuang often are used synonymously, but it's actually a little bit separate. And Shazhou is where the scriptoria are. Shazhou is where there are about 3,000 families, mostly Chinese, who were ruled over by the Tibetans during the Tibetan Empire when the Tibetans occupied this area from 786 to 848. All right, so let's talk about where these scrolls come from and how they have come down to us and how it's possible for somebody like me to go to the British Library and consult 1,650 sutra copies among many other manuscripts. The story, which many of you may know, is that Wang Wenlu opened up the cave. He's the Taoist caretaker of that cave complex at the time, around the turn of the 20th century. And from 1900 to 1907, thereabouts, he's taking some objects out, showing them to people, making gifts of them, gifting sutras to different potentates, to different administrators, and word gets out. Stein is on one of his expeditions from 1906 to 1908. He's been sent by the British Museum to recover many art objects, cutting frescoes off walls, for example, also finding manuscripts. He hears about this cache of manuscripts in Dunhuang. And he goes and he meets Wang Wenlu. Now here you can see manuscripts in piles. And this was a photograph taken by Stein. He didn't actually go into cave 17, 3 cubic meter cave, where all the manuscripts were piled. It was a mess in there. You couldn't sit down in the cave. There wasn't room. Wang Wenlu took manuscripts out, bundle by bundle and gave them to Stein to look at. The reason that he did this, besides being paid a little bit, was that Stein impressed upon him, suggested to him, or didn't correct him when Wang suggested, that he was a reincarnation of the great traveler Xuanzang, come back from the West. So this this helped Stein in his cause, allowed him to view these manuscripts and then eventually to purchase them and send them back to the British Museum in London. So there's Cave 17. You're looking through the wall of Cave 16 and you see a statue there of Hongyan. This was originally a reliquary cave for Hongyan. It had his personal effects and his personal manuscripts, and then it was filled up with manuscripts, probably sealed off because it was filled up. At least that's one of the hypotheses as to why the Cave 17 was sealed. So that happened in the early to mid 11th century. In that 3 cubic meter cave, you have tens of thousands of manuscripts in all of the languages of the Silk Road. And it's not just Stein, but also Pellio and other explorers who take these to the different archives of Europe, mostly to London and to Paris. Okay, so in terms of the Tibetan manuscripts, I'm starting to narrow down what we're looking at. Most of these date from the 8th to the 11th centuries. The Tibetan occupation of Dunhuang, as I mentioned, is from 786 to 848. It's not the case that all of these manuscripts date from Tibetan occupation. The Tibetan language was used by the regime that succeeded the Tibetans. It wasn't the case that Dunhuang was Tang, and then it was Tibetan, and then it was Tang again. It was Tang, then it was Tibetan, and after 848, Tibetans were thrown out by Zhang Yitao, and they became the Guiyijun. You return to righteousness, or return to righteousness army. And when you look at dynastic histories of China, like the Songshu, they talk about these different dynasties as if they are foreign. So it's a real question. Is the Guiyijun a Chinese dynasty or is it a foreign dynasty? And Chinese writers were of two minds about this. But the point to make is that after the Tibetans left, people still used Tibetan as a lingua franca. The rulers of the Guiyijun communicated with the Khotanese through Tibetan. A lot of people who were Buddhist practitioners took on Tibetan names and used Tibetan. Tibetan was a language of religion at this time. Okay, so where did they go? Stein got his hands on the manuscripts in 1907, and then he sent them by ship to London. So they arrive in 1909, and the crates are then unpacked. The gentleman you see there with the fabulous mustache is named Fred Andrews, and he was the one who was responsible for unpacking these crates. And we'll get back to him a little bit later. So they start off at the British Museum. The Chinese manuscripts stay there. The Tibetan manuscripts and manuscripts in other languages end up being moved to the India Office Library and Records. The India Office Library and Records is a colonial institution. It has inherited its raison d'etre from the East India Company. But then you have 1947 coming along, independence, partition. You don't need an India office anymore, so they get rid of it. But as with many bureaucracies that just don't easily come to a screeching halt, the manuscripts stay there for another 20 years before they're actually relocated into another India office library, which has to be there to house them. This one is at Blackfriars Road, 197, which is now a high-rise building of metal and glass. The British Library is established in 1973, and it's not until 1982 that the Tibetan manuscripts and other manuscripts come from Blackfriars Road to the British Library and join its collection there. So the Stein manuscripts don't arrive in the British Library until 1982. All right, so getting into the labor and who dealt with these manuscripts once they were in London. Oral Stein really wanted to see this discovery of his, as he understood it, to be mined, to be understood, to be published, to be appreciated. And he was very frustrated that publication was dragging on, that people were unable to catalog the manuscripts to the extent that he wanted. And very little had actually been done by way of catalogs when Orlstein died. In terms of some of the progress that was made, the great Buddhologist Louis de la Vallée-Poisson basically spent all of World War I in Cambridge and in London working with the manuscripts. He created a catalog of the Tibetan manuscripts in the Stein collection. The catalog was not of all of the manuscripts, but only of 765 shelf marks that he assigned to them, so the first 765. And it wasn't published until long after his death in 1962. The gentleman in the glasses had a hand in publishing that. He, together with an assistant in the 1950s, were working on bringing the La Vallée-Poisson's catalog to light. And it's due to his work that it actually ended up being published. He himself also was looking at Dunhuang manuscripts, Tibetan Dunhuang manuscripts, in his own work, particularly to do with social history, military history, and the military colonies of the Tibetan Empire. Bringing it up to the present day, in terms of catalogs, those numbers that were assigned by Louis de la Vallée-Poisson, VP numbers they were called, they were superseded by IOL numbers, India Office Library Tibet numbers. These were assigned by Sam Van Dyke in 1999 up to the present. Mostly the work was done in 1999 to 2001. And if you go to the website of the International Dunhuang Project, one can look up manuscripts by these shelf marks. And find them often with accompanying digital images. Okay, so in terms of what we have in this cache of manuscripts, linguistically, there are manuscripts in Chinese, in Khotanese, in Sanskrit, in Uyghur, even in Hebrew. As I said, nearly all of the languages of the Silk Road. And you have, genre-wise, historical texts, ritual texts, astrological and legal texts, and it's these that have generally exercised scholars. We've been interested in these more than any other text, even if they're just a small minority of what's there. Some of the more famous documents that we have there are fragments of the Tang Code, the Old Tibetan Chronicle that I've worked on in detail, Tang transformation texts, Chinese classics, and non-Buddhist Tibetan ritual texts. In terms of Buddhism, people have focused on Chan and on Mahayoga. That goes especially for Sam Van Skaik and Jake Dalton in the way that they've used the Dunhuang manuscripts. But the single largest group of manuscripts that you have there are sutras. The Vajracchedika, for example, is probably the most numerous apart from the Aparamitayo. But you have the Heart Sutra, you have many, many copies of canonical sutras. So this brings us to the largest group of texts, the single largest coherent group of texts. And these are sutras that were given as a gift for the Tibetan emperor. They're commissioned in the year 826. And you can break this up into the long and the short. You can break it up into the Chinese and the Tibetan. You can break it up into the philosophical and the devotional. The longest text that was copied, 8 copies of the Shatha Sahasrika Prajnaparamita in Tibetan, and 3 copies of the same sutra in Chinese, the Mahaprajnaparamita. And then the short one is the Aparamitayo. These copies are made in Tibetan, and the copies are also made in Chinese. Of course, there's a very different character to them. You can sit down and copy out an Aparamitayo in an hour. It's about 2,500 syllables, but it's going to take you, if you were working on your own, weeks, if not months, to do the same thing for the Shatha Sahasrika Prajnaparamita. It's humongous. And of course, that is seen by many as the embodiment, the apogee of Madhyamaka philosophy, of elite Buddhist philosophy, whereas the Aparamitayo, though by the numbers it might be the most numerous and most popular Tibetan sutra and Buddhist sutra in the history of Buddhism, is generally looked at as a boring text, a kind of embarrassing text. It's a Dharani sutra. It's to do with this worldly aims. So it's not received the kind of attention that the Parchin have. So just to impress upon you the numbers that we're talking about and how many documents there are, how many folia. So this commission started in 826, but it's clear from administrative documents that it was not finished 10 years into it. So 10 years in, there's still back and forth with administrators about, you haven't paid us enough, we don't have the receipts, what's going on here? And you can get an idea of why this might be the case when you appreciate how big this is. So one Shatasahasrika in Tibetan, his four dumbu, it has 76 bumpo, or rolls, basically equivalent to juan in Chinese. Each bumpo is almost 8 folia, and this would make 2,400 folia in one complete Shatasahasrika Prajnaparamita. You're making 8 of those, that's 19,200 folio. That's a lot. So those are quite a few leaves. If the wind starts to blow and they're going loose, you're going to have a hard time getting those all back together again. Now that's just for the Shatasahasrika. If you look at the AP, the Aparamitaya, the numbers are about the same, except it's not folio, it's copies. Right, so in Paris you have 3,000 to 4,000 folia of the Shatasahasrika and about 600 rolls of the Aparamitaya. In London, it's the inverse. You have 200 to 400 folia of the Shatasahasrika and 1,650 Aparamitaya. Now, these documents were the ones that were left over after the so-called foreign devils on the Silk Road came through. What they left behind were these ones. And these are the ones that haven't really received all that kind of attention because, of course, they're not as interesting as epics, they're not as interesting as divination. And this is why, in Gansu, you have 6,000 folia of these, and you have 5,000 rolls of Aparamitaya. These have been recently cataloged by Madhu. You have some collections in St. Petersburg, a few in Kyoto, Taipei, even Dublin. And this is only, as it says, to tell one side of the story. Here I'm not even focusing on the Chinese Aparamitaya. All right, so in terms of the shelf marks, or the press marks, as they're sometimes called. I mentioned that De la Vallée Poussin stopped at 765. Scholars from the Toyo Bunko, led by Tsueko Yamaguchi, in 1979, worked from microfilms, and they extended these VP numbers, but this didn't really take on, and the British Library took it upon themselves to create a new numbering system, again extending De la Vallée Poussin's numbers. So they went all the way up to ITJ 1774. That's how many shelf marks you have under this particular shelf mark. Now, one of the confusing things about this, and those who work in archives might appreciate it, is that it's not the case that when you see ITJ 1774, that there are 1,774 objects, manuscripts, fragments, scrolls. Rather, some shelf marks include multiples. So 104, for example, includes about 150. 105 also includes quite a few, and so on. Most importantly, the shelf mark 310 has 1,210 sub-shelf marks. Each one of those is a roll of Aparamitaya. There you can see a stamp. Also, this is on shelf mark IOL TIMJ 310.1208, almost at the end. There are only four of these rolls that remain in roll format. This is one of them, and here you can see the stamp on it that says 10th October 1929, India Office Library. Not all of them have this. This scroll was probably misplaced in the scroll box for several decades and rediscovered a few years back by Sam van Schaik, which is why it escaped being transformed into a booklet. The other one that remains as a scroll deliberately is IOL TIMJ 310.1, the very first. It maintained its format. So this is easily the biggest group in the entire collection of Stein manuscripts in the British Library. It's about 40% of the Stein Tibetan collection. That's to exclude those outside of the IOL TIMJ series, but still the point is made, this is the largest group of manuscripts. All right, so one question you might ask is why were there so many? Why so many copies? What's the point of having so many copies of this, this sutra? That goes back to what kind of a sutra it is. When I mentioned this is kind of a Buddhist chain letter, you have the Dharani inscribed on a rock in Lepo. This is near Dege. And it's very nice because it's not just the Dharani itself, it's not just the sutra itself telling you from the horse's mouth, as it were, what it's good for and why you should copy it. Here it's a Tibetan putting it in his own words on a rock wall. It says, this Dharani extends life and removes sins. The gods will also protect you. In your next life, you shall not be reborn in a lower realm, shall not be reborn a woman, and so on. Besides that, besides all the boons that you get, not having an untimely death, not going to the three lower realms, by reciting the sutra, by copying the sutra also, in the manner of what's been called the Mahayana cult of the book, sanctifies the place where it is copied, where it is recited, where it is caused to be copied, where it is caused to be recited, and so on. So it has this kind of power, especially when we think of it as a royal document for a king, as something approaching a palladia or multiple palladia. This is really just an excuse to put Marcel Lalou and her beautiful portrait up on the screen. She's made a fantastic catalog of nearly all of the Paleo-Tibetan collection in Paris. And the third volume of her catalog goes into detail on many of the Shatasahasrika Prajnaparamita sutras. She left off the Aparamitaya, though. Again, there's a bit of double standard or neglect when it comes to these sutras. The first person to make a critical edition of the text, Sten Kono, said that once he'd done this, there is no point in anyone else revisiting, quote-unquote, this dull sutra. So she also wrote three articles on sutra copying in the 1950s, and then you have Akira Fujieda writing also on sutra copying. And then you have catalogs, or quasi-catalogs, they're documentations of these Aparamitaya sutras by Nishioka Soshu, continuing Lalu's work in Paris, by Lev Savitsky in St. Petersburg, by Huang Lenghuan in 1982 for some Gansu collections, Dunhuang Academy, Dunhuang Museum, and so forth, and then superseded by Ma De, Ma De's most recent catalog of the Gansu collections. All right, so when we talk about making catalogs of this, it's actually falling short in most cases of what you would think of as a catalog with measurements, with implicit and with explicit as a bare minimum. Most often what you have are the dimensions, the number of panels of paper, the number of columns, the lines per column, the name of the scribe, and the name or names of the editors. Here you can see one that's unrolled. This is an unrolled single Aparamitaya copy. It's in six columns, as you see, and that's three sheets of paper. Each sheet of paper is called a yu. So these would have been glued together here and here. The verso is completely blank. So when I talk about catalog and not quite being a catalog, this documentation is from Huang Wenhuan, and it's giving measurements. So here you have 151, that should be an X, by 31, so it's 31 centimeters high, 151 centimeters long, is 19 lines per column. This is a single sutra, as opposed to a multiple sutra. Very often, a single roll will contain more than one sutra. So you can have one single long roll with up to 15 sutras in it. All right. So, to get to the punchline, and to go back to London, how did this happen? How did they transform over 1,000 rolls into nearly as many booklets, or quite a few more booklets, in fact? Now, suppose you were to go to the Asian and African Studies reading room on the third floor of the British Library, and you were to ask for a shelf mark that pertain to one of these sutras. You would be presented with a box. This large red box is called a volume. Opening this volume, there would be a stack of booklets. This stack has 79 booklets in it. There's 79 there. They're almost A4 in measurement. Opening up a booklet, you would have the first page, and then you'd open that first page and you could see Tibetan text. So this would be the first and the second columns, pages 2 to 3. Leafing through it, you've got pages 4 to 5, 6 to 7, then the final panel of the sutra with the scribal colophon. Turn it over, and there you have the back side. Now there you can see the spine that they've made here with craft paper. You have the shelf mark or the press mark on the first page, and the conservators have added in pencil the roll number and the panel number, essentially so that when these panels were separated, they wouldn't get shuffled. So what are we talking about here in terms of this binding that I just showed you in virtually flipping through it? Well, this is called butterfly binding. It's a technique known in China for quite a while. You have some of them among the Dunhuang manuscripts. And because it's a Chinese tradition, that's why you have it going this way, A, B, C, D, as opposed to A, B, C, D. But in the case of Tibetan, you would have to imagine a mirror image of that, or English for that matter. So the conservators essentially created a butterfly binding with craft paper, and this is how they transformed rolls into booklets. Now, the mystery of this one is, when did this happen and who did it? And I've been speaking with curators, older curators who have some institutional memory at the British Library, and some who also worked at the British Museum. And some of the things that they mentioned is this period from 75 to 83. In 1975, Peter Lawson and Howard Nelson went to China, and they became impressed by a lot of different conservation techniques there and began to adopt them for the Chinese collections in the British Museum. In particular, they started mounting manuscripts as if they were paintings. But this might be where this comes from. And one of the curators that I was speaking with, one of the conservators rather, she believes that she remembers doing this kind of work. So this would be the 1970s, 1980s. So that's one lead. Now you can faintly see in the upper right-hand corner, pencil, where the curators have added 1/1, 2/1, and 3/1, respectively, on those images from left to right. So the numerator there, the number on the top, is the panel number, and under that, the denominator is the roll number. So as I say, they did this, I assume, so that once they had detached these rolls, once they detached the panels from each other, they couldn't shuffle the pages. They couldn't shuffle them and end up with documents that were in the wrong order. So how do you do that? How do you take a scroll, and separate it? We're talking 70s, perhaps earlier. This could have been happening in them from anywhere from the 20s to the 80s, but it looks like 70s or 80s. So how you would do that at that point would be water and steam. Actually, I'll just jump ahead and show you this one. So you use water and steam to separate the panels, and that leaves you a wet edge. And that wet edge has 9th century glue on it. And that 9th century glue is thirsty. And what did it suck up in this case? Well, somebody put it on newsprint. And there's 4 or 5 shelf marks that I've noticed where there is this kind of newsprint in the margins as a result of this process. One of the other things that they did, presumably before separating them, was to write down the number. When you have one roll that has multiple sutras in it, write down how many are on there. So there you see the number 3 in pencil. In the middle of that, that's the first page of the now created booklet, 3 tells you that there's going to be 3 sutras there. So once the booklets are created, then those constitute subshelf marks. Each object is cataloged as a subshelf mark. Right? So you have each of those as shelf marks, but then you also have numbering. So on the spine there, you can see in pencil again, top left corner, number 1. So each of the booklets in this volume would have a number assigned to it. Each of the booklets in the same volume, if you turn it over, has numbers 79 through 1 with pencil strike through. What happened was that somebody initially numbered them wrong. They numbered them backwards. They had taken them essentially with a stack upside down and numbered them from 1 to 79. And later on, Sam van Schaick, in I think 2000 or 2001, saw this had been done, struck through every single one of them, turned them over, and then had to renumber them. That didn't happen in too many cases, but it happened in a few. All right, in terms of the marks that you see on these, the pointer's not working, so I'll just have to gesticulate. You can see pencil up there, CH73, XI, the Roman numerals, CH for Xianfodong, Table 1000 Buddhas, and the same mark here in red pen that is bled to pink. Here you can see it's in black ink. So who wrote these down? Who put these marks there? Now these are the site numbers, and Stein was an archaeologist. So when he went into K-17, or rather when he had these documents taken out of K-17 for him, he made sure that he noted them. They came in bundles, and he'd give every object in a bundle the same shelf mark so that you would know, or the same site number, so that you would know they were part of the same bundle. So there in K-16, working with Jiang Xiaowan, they added in red and black ink these site numbers. But they didn't do that for everything. There was a lot to go through for them. 1909, when Fred Andrews, he of the beautiful mustache who we saw earlier on, unpacks the crates in London, he also starts writing some of these site numbers on there. So he's making up for what hadn't been done by Stein. And then those marks in pencil, well, that's probably the work of a subsequent curator. So besides that, you have, besides the site numbers, you have the press marks, the shelf marks. First assigned by De La Vallée Poisson during World War I with the help of Miss C.M. Ridding. And then you have some others who are writing these onto the manuscripts or onto notes or onto stickers. Probably this was done by F.W. Thomas and by his assistant, Miss A.F. Thompson, up until the 1930s. The conservation record in terms of who did what and the paper trail is really lacking. You don't have anything pre-1973, pre-British Library, and even those records for the British Library are really wanting. So it's kind of a black hole until we come to 1999 and the work of Sam van Schaick in the digital age. But you can see here different handwriting. Sometimes we can link this to F.W. Thomas. I have samples of his handwriting from letters that he wrote to Geza Urai. And then you also see there's the blue crayon, you know, who wrote the blue crayon, who wrote in that fainter ink, the number 28. These are all questions to be answered. All right, so to close the book on that particular case, the question is, when were these rolls made into booklets? And as I say, it looks like 75 to 83 is the answer, but it's not a closed case yet. It's not definitive. The other answer would be, if all of these are supposed to be in the shelf mark, the subshelf mark 310, why are there over 100 that are outside of it? Did the Vallée Poisson just miss those, or is there some other reason? And then also, as I was saying from the previous side, who wrote these different marks that we find on the manuscripts? When can we say this was Stein? When can we say this was John? When was it Fred? When was it F.W. Thomas? When was it Louis de la Vallée Poisson? Okay, so we're going to move back now, away from Tales from the Archive, to the case of the rubbed out scribes, going back to the 9th century, back to the scriptoria of Shajo. All right, so what you can see here in the top slide is Li Tenlegji. But Li Tenleg has something fishy about him. What's fishy there is that somebody else's name was there, and someone, presumably Li Tenleg, dropped a little bit of water there and rubbed it off, and then wrote Li Tenleg. In the second one, there's not even such a strong attempt, ostensibly, to deceive. You have him lasher di, very desultory strike through. He's not bothering to try to hide the fact that it was him lasher who wrote this. But then below it, in separate hand, chan nang le i di. For those of you who know Tibetan, you can see that the grammar here is appalling. So you would expect an ergative, but you've got a genitive in the second one, in the first one you've got nothing. That's really typical for a colophon. Scribes could copy, they could make shapes. They couldn't necessarily write. You could dictate something to them. But when they had to write and compose on their own, very often you have this kind of lax scribal hand in the colophon, a colophonic hand, where what had been beautiful before is now in a scrawl, and then also a very lax grammar. But the question is, who rubbed out these scribes, and why? All right, so this is kind of a peek inside the documentation that I've been doing since January 2013, first with Dorje Tundup, and then with Louis Doni. So we've documented all of these copies of the Aparamitaya. We have the site number, the roll number, noting whether it's complete, the number of panels, the number of columns, the number of lines per column, the type of dharani, we'll get into the dharani in a moment, the name of the scribe, the name of the editors. In every 10th shelf mark or so, we would do a transcription of the explicit and of the full colophon, and we'd make notes on paleography and any corrections that the editors had made. So this is the sort of database that we're working from. Again, short of the full catalog, there's no implicit. And we're not bothering with the measurements, but quite a lot of documentation nonetheless. So looking to the colophons, we find two types. There's a scribal colophon, where it would say so-and-so wrote this, and the brackets there and the braces show you just how lax the grammar can be. And then you have the editorial colophon, usually with three editors. Somebody edited this, so-and-so edited it again, and so-and-so edited it the third time. Here you can see the scribal and the editorial colophons in the image. The scribal colophon, Bamphalegdi, and then in red down below, the editor's colophon. Very often the editorial red is used in this way, just like a teacher marking essays. Now, we've seen how the scrolls were disassembled. Let's look a little bit into their assembly. The scrolls were lined. They were ink guidelines and ink margins, ink gutters as well. On the top, you can see it's four panels and eight columns. The eighth column is almost taken out entirely by the colophon, but then you can see it would be cut there, there, and there. And then in the second one, you have seven columns, 3.5 sheets of paper. So it's economizing a little bit on paper. On the bottom, five columns, but one column, the last one, is over wide. So here you actually have two normal size sheets, cuts there, and then one three-quarter size sheets. You're economizing on paper even more. But this one on top is the one that predominates. And it seems that norms shook out in practice, and that as people were copying sutra after sutra and producing sutra after sutra, they came to find the most expedient means to do so, the most efficient ways, and that is three sheet, six column, 19 lines per column. Right, so these standards seem to be coalescing in practice. It doesn't seem to be the case that you have, from the start, a rule, this is how it shall be done and you shall not deviate from this standard. But rather, different scriptoria are using different methods, and then eventually the more efficient modes work out. So these are the general measurements. Each panel of paper is 45 centimeters. That's standard for paper during this time produced in Dunhuang. 31 centimeters high. This is one of the reasons we didn't do measurements for all of them, because if it's a three-sheet sutra, if it's a three-panel sutra, well, each panel is 45 centimeters, so why bother measuring it every time? The leading is 15 centimeters. The gutters are also 15 centimeters. Each column is about 21 centimeters wide. And the most important point, which we've seen already from that number three, is that some of these rolls are a single sutra and some are multiple sutras up to 15. You also have scriptoria referred to as da, teams or groups, named groups, and they are audited as well. Here you have wooden slips that are used to audit these groups. So on the bottom you can see lawo da site, making an account of lawo's scriptorium. And here it says yuksumba, it's written on the verso also, but we don't have the verso. But in this case, yuksumba is exactly what we're talking about. You're making a sutra out of three sheets. How many of those sutras are you making? 253 of them. So they're going to do the math. It's going to be 253 times 3. That's what you have on the verso. So what's interesting about this in the single sutra rules versus the multiple sutra rules is that you have different bundles, and the different bundles are distinguished by Stein's site numbers that he assigned to them. So what we found in looking through these bundles is that a given bundle either includes only single sutra rules, or it includes a mixture of single and multiple sutra rules, with mostly multiple sutra rules. Those bundles that have only single sutra rules are largely edited sutras. They have editor's colophons, splashes of editorial red in the sutra itself. Those bundles where you have mixed in multiple sutra rules, not edited at all. You also see this difference in the Dharani. In those unedited mixed bundles with mostly multiple sutra rules, you have the Dharani type A. The red is just to demonstrate the differences between the two forms of the Dharani. And in those mostly edited single sutra rule bundles, you have Dharani type B. This way of referring to the Dharanis as type A and type B was pioneered by Akira Bucheda in a 1962 article. He was the first one to notice this. I should say also that in the Chinese Aparamitayu, the Dharani is a little bit different, and it's grouped into 15 sections that are numbered, so you actually have numbers next to each group of syllables. So here you have an interesting situation, because it would seem that there's a big difference. And on the face of it, if you were just given this data set, you'd say, well, one's earlier than the other. One type of bundle, which is using one type of Dharani and is edited, versus another type of bundle, which is using a different Dharani and is unedited, those must be made at different times, maybe even different places. Problem? Same scribes in the colophons, same editors in the colophons. These are contemporaneous. These scribes are mostly Chinese. These scribes also copied the Chinese Aparamitaya. They also copied the Tibetan Shaka Sahasrika Prajnaparamita. In one administrative document, it mentions 80 scribes and 20 editors. In fact, there were quite a lot more than that if we go through our database of names that we've created from going through these sutra copies. Right, so how did it work? You can assume how it would work, and if you were to make a guess, you'd probably be right, because they worked from exemplars. These scribes used exemplars. These exemplars were called pe in order to make sutras or sutra copies. Dharma is the old Tibetan term for sutra, before the term do and dode were used. not only did scribes use the exemplars, but editors also used exemplars. When they're looking at scribes' work and they're correcting it, they have their own exemplar before them, and what they do is comparing and correcting that, looking particularly for omissions and additions. In terms of what they were called, the scribes' names and the terms used to refer to them go back to the fact that this is a gift for the Tibetan emperor, commissioned first in A26. They are men of letters who write the Shatasahasrika Prajnaparamita, the benefaction for the son of gods, that's to say the gift for the Tibetan emperor. Shorthand, Kuyamba, gift people. Sometimes they're just scribes, Yikken. Now, in terms of the editorial process, very often what you find are corrections in the same places in each sutra copy. When they're in red ink, they're easier to see. And setting out to study these in the first place, I was hoping to find an orthographic baseline for how Tibetan language changes over time. We don't have any Tibetan grammars that date to this period, so you have to find out what the grammar is from actual practice. What better way to do this, I thought, than looking at a canonical text sponsored by the Tibetan administration as a gift for the Tibetan emperor. Unfortunately for me, and for the study of orthography, these editors were not pedants. They were not crossing out every error. Instead, what they did was make these same corrections. So here's what we did in our documentation for about every 10th shelf mark. We wrote down the explicit, which is always the same. Sometimes it's gago. Sometimes tsokso. Then you have the colophon, lalogi de, again, the paradox of the illiterate scribe, it should be lalogi de. Dumgi shu, dumgi edited it, lengpyo yangshu, chikeng sumshu. And then we note the corrections. In this case, we wrote typical, from do to dode, from gangshik to gangalashik, from shuk tso to shukshing tso. These are not very important corrections. What it seems is going on is editors essentially showing that they've done their job, putting a little bit of red on the page so you know that they've been there. In these editorial colophons also, like this one that you see in red here, the norm is to have a team of three editors. So you have three names there. Very often it's the case that when one looks at these colophons, there's two separate scribal hands, two people who have written the colophon. So one person has written his or her name, and then the name of one of his or her colleagues, and then a colleague has written his or her own name. One implication there is that it might be just one editor who's doing these corrections and then writing their name and the name of a sub-editor, and then a third editor comes along, looks at it, okays it, and writes their name. The consequence of this, where you would have an editor writing his or her co-editor's names, is that these names are misspelled. So you know who this editor is. You see Dumgi over and over again if you go through these texts. But sometimes he's called Dumge, sometimes he's Dumgi, and sometimes it's a Gilok, sometimes it's a Gihu. So you have these kind of variations, and you think, why can't these editors spell their names right? They're professional editors. Well, it wasn't them. It was their friends who were writing their names for them. So in terms of using the Chinese Aparamitaya is a comparandum. I've not really dipped into that to the extent that I would like to so far, but I will just say that you have something similar in terms of use of rubrics, use of red, editorial red, for the editorial colophon in many of these copies. As you can see in this one here, the editor's name is right next to the scribe's name. And then also, in some cases, the scribe writes his or her name in Tibetan. You have that in this particular copy of the Chinese Aparamitaya. You have fewer signs of editing in these Chinese sutras than you do in the Tibetan sutras. Now this points to double standards also. They're the same scribes and editors editing these Aparamitaya sutras as are editing the Mahaprajnaparamita in Tibetan and the Shatasahasrika. The Maha in Chinese and the Shatasahasrika in Tibetan. But when there were errors in those, they got rid of them. They said, no, you need to fix that. So they did that by writing this character Dwe, usually in the top margin, sometimes maybe when they're really ticked off, in big letters all over the page. And in Tibetan, they called it Ro. So I use the word Ro, and then the number of that Ro in this very interesting system of numbers that was used in early Tibet. So they wouldn't let an error stand, not like in the AP, where you would show that you've done some editing work. You would leave that editorial right on the page. With the Parchin, with the Prajnaparamita Sutras, if there's an error, you have to get rid of it, and you have to bring in a replacement team who are going to come and rewrite that particular panel and stick it in there and make sure that they're starting where they should start and they're ending where they should end. So that's a very clear double standard. So a question comes up, why are there such differences? Differences between bundles, single sutra bundles and multiple sutra bundles, between dharanis. Why are these two different types of dharanis? There's even a third type that I've not introduced. It's very rare. And why these differences in editorial standards? So one hypothesis, and one that I've toyed with before, is that the ethic of mass reproduction of this sutra eroded norms. And it's a kind of thread that goes all the way through to London, that goes all the way through to every place that these sutras have been kept and where people have tried to keep track of them and people have tried to document them. They've frustrated attempts. They've frustrated attempts in the formats that we can see, the coalescing of norms through practice. It's all a little bit messy. And then also in the way that the rules were separated into booklets. We see different methods for how this was done in London as well. So here you can kind of toy with it and think of the Aparamitaya Sutra, going back to the motif of the chain letter, as something that wants to live, something that wants to continue, something that wants you to copy it, to pass on, to continue. And this is part of what seems to frustrate those who work with it. The other thing is that this project dragged on for a long time. In one administrative text, you have a dispute over how much the scribes and editors are being paid, that they haven't received what they were meant to receive in grain, and that the receipts haven't been shown also for the expenditure that was supposed to be approved to allow this project to happen, which means that this gift for the Tibetan emperor might not actually materialize. So there's kind of a veiled threat there as well from the scribes and editors of Shajo to the administrators in Guajo. That brings us back to the mystery and the question, who rubbed out those scribes? One point to make here is that when you see a scribal colophon, when you see a scribe's name here, this is not a signature. It's not that I finish my sutra and I sign my name. We know that because we see sutra after sutra that are all attributed to the same scribe. So Kenpen is a scribe. We can look at 40 different sutras scribed supposedly by Kenpen, and we see that 38 of them have the same handwriting and two don't. We know there's something going on there. We know that those two weren't written by Kenpen. So that's one issue. The other one is this one of the name being rubbed out. In this case, one scribe has written the sutra, the name has been rubbed out, and then another scribe's name has been put there. So it's different than writing the sutra and then writing your name there, or having somebody else write the sutra and then writing your name. Now, here we have some nice 9th century highlighting. And this is an administrative document, ITJ 1359, to do with the scribes and to do with accounting for what they've been given in paper and ink. And here we're introduced to somebody called the Rupmapa. The Rupmapa was the official in charge of accounting for various things, among them paper and ink. Now, the formula that they use in this document is to take the number of sheets that were originally given out to a scribe, which is kept in a karcha, or a record. You subtract from that the number of completed panels that they've submitted in their sutras, their scribe sutras. You can also subtract those discards that they've made when they've messed up when some water has gone onto the page, when it's been damaged, and they've handed those in, and those have been recognized as discards. And also, each scribe had a writing board. The writing board was made of paper. It was a cover for the sutras. That's also subtracted. It doesn't count against you. But you add those up, you subtract them from the karchak, from the record of how much that scribe was given, and if there's a shortfall, that scribe is in trouble. So if you were given out more paper than you gave back scribe sutras, 10 lashes per piece of paper. So this is an administrative legal document, and it's totting up the debts of all of these scribes. Some of them owe 500, or sorry, not that much, some of them owe up to 200 sheets of paper. Now, this can lead to prison of the scribe himself or herself, or of a guarantor, a family member. Stocks were prescribed for this as well, so it's a pretty harsh punishment. Now, going back to this text, in some interlinear notes, you can see one that's upside down there at the bottom of the image. You have a guy named Sheikh Latun, and Sheikh Latun takes over some of the debts of paper of his scribes. His fellow scribes who stand to be whipped 10 times per sheet of paper. In the interline, it says, Sheikh Latun has taken this over. So he's saving them. They're not going to be whipped. He's taking that. So what do we make of this? Is he just a nice guy? Is he doing a kind of bodhisattva activity as a Buddhist scribe? Maybe. Is he a scapegoat? Did he even have some choice in the matter? Did somebody write his name there because they really hated the guy? Maybe. Or is he a hustler? Has he got a kind of black market trade going on in paper, in scribe sutras? Does he have a pile of scribe sutras that he can give to people? Does he have people who are kind of subcontracting for him? Is he lending on interest? Also a possibility. That much more a possibility because we have records of loans of paper. Paper was valuable. The tools of the trade, paper, ink, pens, knives, these were traded back and forth between scribes. This is a loan contract. Ironically, it's a paper maker who takes a loan of paper. Takes 200 long sheets from a counselor, Gyesi. He pays Gyesi back, not from his own paper that he's made, but by taking a sub-loan from a sutra scribe. So the sutra scribe has this paper given to him by the government, and he loans it so that Gyesi can be repaid. But Se Wen, scribe, falls ill, and his papermaker, Shang Heido, hasn't paid him back yet for this sub-loan. This is what the document's for. This is what it's about. So you have a trade of paper going on. This is not the black market trade. This is the above-board trade with the contract. This is the writing board that I was telling you about. You can see how it's bent at the edges. That's because it would be over the edges of the sutras. The large format Shatasahasrika sutras, they measure about 20 by 73 centimeters. So after these were unpacked and people were writing with them, they would take those sheets and they use this as a ledger. So they'd jot things down, they'd do dry runs at the different things that they were writing for different clients, sometimes legal charges, sometimes letters. They'd do doodles. You see kind of nasty writings too, scurrilous writings and accusations. Lots of the time it says, nobody steal this is mine. And then very often it's loans of knives and loans of pens and ink and paper that are written here. Right, so from all of that evidence, we can close this case. We can say it's the scribes that did it. The black market economy in paper and the normal economy in paper, it certainly accounts for it. The motives would be fear of punishment. 10 lashes is pretty serious punishment for each sheet of paper. Also, the possibility of profit. If Sheikh Latun was lending on interest, if Sheikh Latun did stand to gain for bailing his fellow scribes out, he can profit. Then also, let's not discount the possibility that he was doing it out of compassion, and that others were doing it out of compassion, trying to help their fellow scribes from being punished. Now, the kind of desultory strike-through you see here, where it's just enough to let you know that his name is crossed out, that and these other attributions, where it's very clear that one scribe wrote it, but it's not the scribe whose name is there in the colophon, That suggests that this was not very secretive. This was kind of out in the open as common practice. You would submit this, and the person doing the accounting would know to attribute that sutra to the lower name and not the name above it. So it doesn't seem to be a kind of illicit practice. Okay, so I'll end with talking about the gift a little bit, to go back to the gift of the sutra. Now, in terms of sutra copying and creating the Aparamitaya Mahayana Sutra, you can look at the sutra itself as kind of a shell, as a record of a devotional action performed, as a receipt. In that sense, the physical object might not be all that important. It's a receipt of merit generated and merits dedicated. It might be the act of copying itself that is the gift. On the other hand, you have the emphasis on these physical objects as sanctifying the place where they are copied and the place where they are kept. So you do have a counterpoint that emphasizes these things as physical objects with power to sanctify. Now the question, did the Tibetan emperor ever receive these, is a difficult one. We don't know if he did. There's no record of him actually receiving this gift. And one thing that we can do in the frustration of not knowing if it happened is pontificate about what it would mean anyway for the Tibetan emperor to receive something. Because when a Tibetan emperor is offered something, in the Old Tibetan Chronicle, for example, or when we're looking at grants that he's made in Central Tibetan inscriptions, those offerings are usually given right back. So the prototype for this would be when Khyumpo Khunse Zutse conquered Sangbu, he offers its 20,000 households to Songtsen Gampo, and Songtsen Gampo gives them right back to Zutse. So you think of dana, you think of a bodhisattva, you think of the kind of manner in which merit is gained by passing it on, the kind of spiritual hot potato of accepting a gift as a bodhisattva. You have to diffuse it, you're a gift diffuser. The Tibetan emperor, who was called a bodhisattva in many sources, does something similar, not necessarily by this Buddhist economy of giving, but by a royal economy of giving. He is the giver, he bestows. When he is given something, he almost cannot but give it back, re-gift it, or spread it out. Now, if we want to actually get into documentary evidence for what happened to these sutras and who did receive them, we know that in 844, some of the inhabitants of Shajo did receive copies of this sutra in a gift. The gift was ordered by Tsimokhen, by the queen, and by her son Wusun. And it was 135 rolls of Chinese Aparamitaya and 480 rolls of Tibetan Aparamitaya. We have this document, and you can see the official seals on the bottom of it, because this is ordering these to be replaced. This is a document ordering these 135 and 480 rolls to be recopied. Because they were given out, there's now a deficit, you have to replace that and then put them back. So that is an interesting circumstance, because you're thinking of it as a kind of body of sutras that can't be nibbled away at without making it whole once more. It's also interesting just in terms of the directionality of the gift. If this is given to the emperor and then eventually it comes back and is given to the subjects. Here you have it coming through a different conduit, not the emperor for whom they were actually commissioned, but for his successors, or through his successors. Right, so after that, they find their way into K17. Interesting circumstance, you have so many panels of paper, you have so many rolls with blank versos. Paper is at a premium. You make paper in Dunhuang, there's an economy for it, but still, there's a lot of paper reuse. These were not reused. Very, very rarely do you see the versos of these being reused for Chinese documents, Tibetan documents, anything. So they find their way into Cave 17. The cave is sealed in the early 11th century, and then nearly 1,000 years later, it's opened up. So you have a long period of silence when nobody's messing with these, and when these are not messing with anybody. And then finally, they're dug up again. They make their way, most of them outside of Dunhuang, a few of them remain there, but they make their way to their strange recipient, to Oral Stein, to his dog Dash, to his friend Fred, to his wife. And there you have the reading room in the British Library. So these new recipients, these new people who are pushing the papers and documenting these, would include all of the conservators and all of the curators in the British Library, those who are transforming the format of these sutras, and then, of course, unfortunate people like me who've taken it upon ourselves to work with such an unwieldy collection as this. Thank you.